installation of pipe, installation of elevated tanks, et cetera, that would go to the heart of the water supply issue. Steve?
Okay, as you, on the sheet, page 19 there, what I've done here is looked at cost on a per lot basis for different components. And if we are actually inside of subdivision, maybe when you're doing water only, we're looking at about an additional $2,650 per lot. Now, what this is not included, I didn't have the availability of with different people, is getting what that total cost was with all the engineering fees, the admin fees, contingency, permitting, and all that. What I gave you yesterday was more in line with that, if you wanted to compare that. What I did do is I sat down with one of the local contractors, and we looked at a section of, it was about 60 lots on a straight line road, and I plugged my numbers in from what I had yesterday, and that came up to about $330,000. He plugged his numbers in, and then we took a stab of what is normal for them with those other contingencies and engineering stuff. My number was $330,000, his number was $334,000, so it matched out good. You could look at this a couple different ways, but again, on the per lot size, you can go down through here on the new subdivision, and we looked at an existing subdivision, as we mentioned yesterday. You have driveway cuts and yards, the first one thing and another like that, then obviously existing is going to cost a bit more when you're dressing that back up and fixing that back up. But when you're looking at 8-inch, you have the pricing there, and then you're looking at water and sewer with 6 and 8, and just some different things. Since we're talking about in my per mile pricing that I gave you yesterday, it includes all the hydrants and the valves and everything, but just to sort of show you what the cost of a hydrant was, that's there in the last little piece on each one of the complete fire hydrants. And we're looking at about $3,750 on new construction and $4,000 on the other. Just adds a little bit to that to take care of what might be needed there. As far as the water towers goes, that I can put it on that sheet there, but going back to them from yesterday's sheet of $2.5 million on a $500,000 elevated tank, and about $1 million on a $500,000 ground storage tank. So these are some of the numbers. There's a little bit, another little section over here from the side. This comes from the fire department determining fire flows. And actually, we're going to probably see a little bit more on that specific thing there about, you know, your amount you're pulling. And then, as Ashley already mentioned earlier this morning, we have to also consider that, you know, if this house catches on fire at 6:30 in the afternoon or 7 o'clock in the afternoon, you've got your normal usage going and whatnot. So you have to take that into consideration.
Going on the gallons in a minute.
Yes, sir. You can do any structure so you know what your fire flow would need if that structure was on fire. When a truck got there, either it was 25% involvement up to 100% involvement. So it's a simple formula, basically a square foot divided by 3. And there are standards in other things that we have to deal with throughout what we put together, and that is one that they look at as a power plant for each structure when they come in, and that's just how we generate. So if the hydrants are being installed, will it be adequate enough to make this fire plant to get to the buildings?
And I think going back to what we said yesterday on these small independent systems where they might have anywhere from 1,000 to a maximum on anything I've seen other than one of ours is a 10,000 gallon tank. You can see by those numbers there going right on board real quick.
I'd like to springboard off of this back to some of the discussion we've had in the last 2 days going I asked the question of staff when we were going through this. I said, imagine that we have a fire in Nelson Hills on the northwest corner. Prevailing wind to southeast. What damage could we expect? I think the response was we would have to draw a line as to where we would be able to sustain, and we would have to acknowledge that we would come from that defensive line back with potentially the loss. Lloyd, is that fair?
Nelson Hill and Guest Road are Lloyd's two favorite developments.
And that's not an overstatement.
That's right.
What I'm trying to do is paint the picture as it's relative to these type of developments. And while we have, as Scotty said, are appreciative of that growth and development and traffic, et cetera, et cetera, now you're taking a different aspect of this, and you're wearing a different hat to the fire prevention and fire response. So I ask you not to give you an answer now, but to add to your thought process. Is this a time when you begin to consider the requirements you want to place on the elements relative to fire and fire prevention? Chairman and I had a discussion on this, and I got a good education on fire code requirements and et cetera. Because he has obviously been doing this since Hector was a buck, and I understood that. My question is not to defend anything, but merely say, is this a factor or is it not a factor? Are you all comfortable, or is this something you want to do previously?
Well, I know this is taking the wrong way. First thing that I feel like we need to be careful about is to not dive too deep into the pool of a what if. The what if could take place in just about any subdivision you want to identify in this community. I mean, you have high winds, road point is a good example. There's a potential. If you have a fire on one structure with some high winds in the right direction, you could lose two or three houses due to that. I mean, that's just what happens. But the concern is that I had brought up Mr. Pritchard's attention and what I was talking about is that some of these houses, if we need to look at some code requirements, you might say, that would kind of help, but would not be all that expensive from the standpoint of, Scotty, you understand this, on those exterior walls where they're next to, you can do fire rated rock on both sides of the walls and then up the roof line to a certain degree. Now that's not going to fully protect it. You're still going to have that what if scenario, perfect storm, if you want to call it that. You're going to still have that. But I think we also need to be considered about the fact of, is there something there that we may need to consider as an add-on that would help that situation? But we bounced it back and to, and everybody has their opinion about it. That we, I don't mean they bounce around, but as we talk about affordable housing in this community, we know that affordable housing cannot be obtained without these the issues. I mean, it's just part of that issue. So that's where we're at with it. I don't want us to overreact to that fact. I don't want us to get bogged down in the issue of the what if.
fair to say that from your perspective, you would not be supportive of requiring in development the inclusion of certain fire restricted conditions based on the density? If the density is a certain amount from a zoning standpoint, would you be opposed to requiring those?
I wouldn't be 100% opposed, but I think we need to look at that. I mean, we already have subdivisions in the city of Alaska where you have that side yard issues. You couldn't get a fire truck in there, you couldn't hardly get a man down through there. I mean, they're literally back flush. Well, the code's already addressed that. If you're within a certain distance, you have to have that assembly that I'm talking about. You can't have windows or opening on both sides because of fire protection. Now, I don't think that we can be, well, I guess you can't be less than, you can't reduce the requirements like if it's an NFPA standard. You can't reduce it, but you can increase it.
You could,
I can do whatever I want. I mean, on the other lot line.
Yeah.
You know, I can extend that and do whatever I want to protect that stuff above and beyond, but not less than that.
Yeah, I mean, there's some.
You can become more restrictive.
You can't be less restrictive. Right. And I was explaining to Mr. Pritchard, I mean, you know, in my year, literally in our field of air conditioning, there's been some houses and subdivisions that were built that literally the air conditioning units that we had to set between the properties was actually on somebody else's property. Because there is no light. I mean, there's no room there. So, this man's air conditioning sitting on this one's property and his air conditioning sitting on that next guy's property.
But there are current national codes in place that we adhere to protect against that.
That's right.
And I mean, you know, in fact, somebody said yesterday, Mark, you know, we want to start trying to fix stuff that's not broken. I mean,
misunderstand, I'm not proposing that you do that. I'm saying, as your discussion
development,
and where you go, is that a factor that you want to consider? That's fine.
Well, I don't really think it can be talking. We're talking about, let's talk about Lowndes County. We don't really have that issue. You can go to other larger cities, and that very exact scenario plays out subdivision after subdivision after subdivision after subdivision. Just take a look at an aerial of some of these things and you'll just see what you got. So, again, I don't want to get too deep off into that pond, but I would have a concern that we would get just that. We'd get too deep into it. And right now, the current codes that we have, if you've got a certain distance, the codes kick in that require that type of fire protection.
Any question on that? Any comment from anybody? Okay. Prior to our